Hello everyone, welcome to Eastigonauts, and today I'm here with a wonderful science chapter, which is fiber to fabric. Let's begin. Fibers. Fibers are classified into two types, natural fibers and the synthetic fibers. Now what are natural fibers? Natural fibers are the fibers obtained from plants and animals. The fibers basically obtained from nature. And they again are classified into two types, animal fiber and plant fiber. Animal fibers are the fibers obtained from animals, and plant fibers are obtained from plants. Animal fibers, examples, wool and silk, which we'll be basically covering in this chapter. And the plant fiber we have already learned last year, which is cotton and jute. Then let's come to the synthetic fiber. Synthetic fibers are man-made fibers and they are designed to make a fabric. Basically, they are made in factories by human beings and not found in nature. Some examples are nylon, rayon, polyester, and terryline. Now, let's throw some light on the process from fiber to fabric. Fibers are thread-like structures, basically found either in nature or made by human beings. And then these fibers are spun into yarns. A long continuous length of interlocked fiber is called a yarn. The process of getting yarn from fibers is called spinning. So the fiber is spun into yarn, which is a continuous length of interlocked fiber. And then this yarn is further woven or knitted into fabric. So then we get the fabric, which is a piece of cloth. And these are again tailored to get the clothing articles we wear, the shirt, the pant, etc. Alright, now let's begin with an animal fiber, wool. Wool is obtained from the fleece or hair of sheep, goat, yak, etc. Some animals, we'll be covering more of them. So stay tuned. These wool yielding animals bear hair on their body, and wool is derived from these hairy fibers. Their hair traps a lot of heat as it is a poor conductor of heat, and this enables them to stay in cold conditions. The hairy skin of sheep has two types of fibers that form its fleece. One is the coarse bird hair, which is the upper part. And then we have the fine soft under hair, which is closer to the skin below the coarse bird hair. And these fine soft under hair, which are close to the skin, they are used for making wool. So these are required. And some breeds of sheep possess only fine under hair, and they are in huge demand because they produce more wool. So their parents are specifically chosen to give birth to sheep which have only soft under hair. And this process of selecting parents for obtaining special characters in their offspring is termed as selective breeding. And in sheep, this is to have more of the soft under hair. Now we come to the wool yielding animals. Let's start with the sheep. Several breeds of sheep are found in different parts of our country. However, the fleece of sheep is not the only source of wool. Let's look at some other animals. Although wool available in the market is commonly sheep wool, the one you use for sweaters or other woolen things, but still, there are other animals yielding wool. The yak. Yak wool is common in the Tibet and Ladakh region in India. And then the goat. We have the Angora goat and the Kashmiri goat. The Angora goat is famous for mohair wool, and Angora goats are found in the hilly regions such as Jammu and Kashmir. The Kashmiri goat. The under fur of the Kashmiri goat is soft. It is woven into fine Pashmina shawls. You must have heard that Kashmiri shawls are very famous, so it is obtained from this goat. Then we have the llama and the alpaca. These two again are animals, similar looking. They are found in South America. Then we have the camel. All of you are familiar with this one. The fur hair on the body of camels is also used as wool. They also yield wool. And then some Indian places where shepherds rear sheep on the hill are Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttaranchal, Arunachal Pradesh, and Sikkim. And then we have the plains, Haryana, Punjab, Gujarat, and Rajasthan. For obtaining wool, sheep are reared and their hair is cut and processed into wool. We'll be looking into this process now. But before that, let's look into the diet of the sheep. So sheep are herbivores and they prefer grass and leaves. But apart from grazing sheep, Rearers also feed them a mixture of pulses, corn, jowar, and oil cakes. Oil cakes is just the material left after taking out oil from seeds. So this one, the image given over here is the oil cake of cotton seed. During winters, the sheep are kept indoors and they are fed on leaves, grain, and dry fodder. Processing fibers into wool. The wool used for knitting sweaters or weaving shawls is the finished product of a long process, which involves the following processes. Six processes, we'll be looking at them in detail. Shearing is just the taking out of wool from the sheep's body. So the fleece of the sheep, along with a thin layer of dead skin, is removed from its body. Machines similar to those used by barbers are used to shave off hair. So if you have ever visited a barber shop, you might have seen machine. It's similar to that. Usually hair are removed during the hot weather. Of course, you can't go and shave off a sheep during winter because it will die of cold. This enables the sheep to survive without a protective coat of hair. Then the hair provide woolen fibers, and wool fibers are then processed to obtain woolen yarn. The next process is scouring, which is basically the washing of the wool. So the sheared skin with hair is thoroughly washed in tanks to remove grease and dust. Nowadays, scouring is also done by machines. Everything is getting advanced nowadays. Then we have sorting. Sorting is just separating different types of wools for different types of purposes. Hairy skin is sent to a factory where hair of different textures are separated or sorted. The next process is the burr separation. First of all, what are burrs? You must have seen on your old sweaters, you know, the small things coming out. Those are burrs. The small fluffy fibers called burrs are picked out from the hair. These are the same burrs which sometimes appear on your old sweaters. The fibers are again, after you know, burr separation, the fibers are scored, again washed and dried. Then the wool is ready to be drawn into fibers, but before that the wool is dyed. The fibers can be dyed into various colors because the natural fleece of sheep is just black, brown or white. So it can be dyed into different colors, not just black, brown or white. After this, spinning happens, which is basically the fibers are straightened, combed and rolled into yarn. So now the yarn are formed. Alright, now this wool industry is a very important means of livelihood for many people in our country. But sorters' job is risky as sometimes they get infected by a bacteria. Who are sorters? The one who are sorting the wool into different textures. Infected by bacterium Bacillus anthracis, the name of the bacteria, and this bacteria causes a fatal blood disease known as anthrax or sorter's disease. Such risks faced by workers in any industry are known as occupational hazards. Also, shearing does not hurt the sheep, just as it does not hurt when you get haircut or your father shaves off his beard. You know, you might have wondered, doesn't the sheep get hurt? No, it doesn't. The uppermost layer of the skin is dead. So we are just taking off the dead skin, not the real one. I mean, not the one sensitive one. Also, the hair of the sheep grows again, just as our hair does. And here we have a beautifully arranged table of the breed of sheep, for what quality of wool they produce and where they are found. So first is Lohi. It produces good quality wool found in Rajasthan and Punjab. Then we have the Rampur Bushehr. It has brown fleece, found in Uttar Pradesh and Himachal Pradesh. The Nali sheep, famous for carpet wool, found in Rajasthan, Haryana and Punjab. Then we have the Bakharwal sheep for woolen shawls, and it is found in Jammu and Kashmir. The Marwari sheep for coarse wool, it is found in Gujarat. And then we have the Patanwadi sheep for hosiery, again found in Gujarat. Now moving on to another animal fiber, silk. Silkworms spin silk fibers from where we obtain silk, silkworms. The rearing of silkworms for silk is known as sericulture, a really important term. Then silk yarn is obtained from the cocoon of the silk moth. So we'll see the life cycle of the silk moth and see how the silk is obtained. Then the silk moths. There is a variety of silk moths which look very different from one another, and the silk yarn that they yield is different in texture. The texture, different in texture means it can be coarse, smooth, shiny, etc. Different textures of silk. Because of this, different types of silk is there. We have the mulberry silk, tassar silk, eri silk, muga silk, and the kosa silk. And another important fact has been given here. Silk yarn is as strong as a comparable thread of steel. Steel thread you'll mostly find in the windows, the wire netting in the window. So you can look at that and you can imagine how strong a silk yarn is. Then we have the life cycle of the silk moth. We need to learn this to learn how silk is obtained in which stage. So first the female silk moth lays eggs. Then the larvae, also known as caterpillars or silkworms, hatch from these eggs shown in the picture. They grow in size while feeding on leaves. When they are ready to enter the next stage of their life, called pupa, they weave a net to hold themselves. Then the silk moth or the larvae, it swings its head in form of figure 8. While this movement of its head, the caterpillar secretes fiber made of a protein. And when this fiber hardens on exposure to air, it becomes silk fiber. Shortly, the caterpillar completely covers itself by silk fibers and turns into pupa. The silk covering is known as cocoon. The development of the pupa into moth continues inside the cocoon. All right. The mulberry silk. The most common silk moth is the mulberry silk moth. Mulberry silk is soft, it is lustrous and elastic, and it can also be dyed into beautiful colors. Sericulture is also known as culture of silkworms. It is a very old occupation in India. Another fact, China leads the world in silk production. India also ranks among the leading silk producing country. The smell of pure silk thread and woolen fiber is similar. Why? A real important question. Because they both are made up of proteins. So the sheep, the hair is made up of proteins, as well as the cocoon in the silk moth is made up of proteins. Now let's see the process from the cocoon to silk. For obtaining silk, silk moths are reared, known as sericulture, and their cocoons are collected. A female silk moth lays hundreds of eggs at a time. The eggs are then stored carefully on strips of cloth or paper, and they are sold to silkworm farmers. The farmers keep eggs under clean and suitable condition with suitable temperature and humidity required for them to hatch. The eggs are warmed to a suitable temperature for the larvae to hatch out. This is done when the mulberry trees bear a fresh crop of leaves because that is the food of the silkworm. The larvae eat day and night and they increase enormously in size. The larvae are kept in clean bamboo trays along with some mulberry leaves. After 25 to 30 days of eating, the caterpillars stop eating and they move into tiny chamber of bamboo in the tray to spin cocoons. The caterpillar or silkworm spins the cocoon inside which the silk moth develops. Then the processing. A pile of cocoons is required for obtaining silk fibers. The cocoons are kept under sun, or they are boiled, or they can be exposed to steam. Anyhow, they have to be heated. The silk fibers then separate out. Threads are taken out from the cocoon for use as silk. This is known as reeling the silk, shown in this picture. Reeling is done in special machines which unwind the thread or fibers of silk moth from cocoon. And now the silk fibers are spun into silk threads, which are woven into silk cloths by weavers. And then this is how we obtain the silk. Now we have a fact about the discovery of silk. The exact time of discovery of silk is perhaps unknown, but according to an old Chinese legend, the Empress Xi Lan Shi was asked by the Emperor Huang Ti to find the cause of the damaged leaves of mulberry trees growing in their garden. The empress found white worms eating up mulberry leaves, and she noticed that they were spinning shining cocoons around them. What happened was that accidentally a cocoon dropped into her cup of tea, and a tangle of delicate threads separated out from the cocoon. This is how silk was discovered. And then the silk industry began in China and was kept a closely guarded secret for hundreds of years. But later on, traders and travelers introduced silk to other countries. And the route they traveled is still known as the Silk Route. So this was quite an interesting fact about the discovery of silk. And with that, we have finished this wonderful chapter, very interesting one. If you like this video, hit the like button, share and subscribe to Eastigo Notes. Hit the bell icon so that you get notified whenever I release a new video. Let me know in the comment section below which part of the video did you like the most. Thank you for listening and have a good day.